become reacquainted with all my friends and meet some new folks. I was the son of a couple of German Jewish refugees that came over from Hitler. And when I was a young man, I was a pacifist. And I never was able to answer my father's concern. I mean, he was a peace person too, but he used to say, well, what do you, that's fine, the pacifism stuff, but what are you going to do about Hitler? What would you have done about Hitler? And I didn't really have an answer to that until I came across a little booklet by a guy named Gene Sharp in about 1969 or so. And it was called Civilian-Based Defense, the Moral Equivalent of War. Well, that filled the blank for me. It made the connection between pacifism and reality. And so I've always been a real fan of Gene Sharp's work. And I know that our speaker today, this morning, is also a fan of his work because she's been working with him for about 14 years, probably 14 years now. She's the director of the Albert Einstein Institution, which is the organization through which Gene Sharp does his work. And I think, as you know, Gene Sharp has very materially affected nonviolent social change efforts around the world. And I'm sure that Jamila will tell us more about that. She began working with Gene Sharp in 2002, and she's been the director of the Albert Einstein Institution since 2009, is that right? 2006.
2002.
You've been the director since
2000? Oh, sorry. Yeah, right. You're correct.
Okay. All right. So, this morning I think we're going to hear some very interesting stuff about how nonviolence actually plays out in the real world from somebody who's been very close to perhaps the greatest living dean of that work, possibly excepting our yesterday's chief keynote speaker. So will you warmly welcome today, Jamila Raqib.
Said unsupported.
Did I do something wrong?
It says unsupported.
So try hitting an escape key or whatever the equivalent is on the Mac to get back to the PowerPoint.
Okay. So maybe I have to watch it like this. Is that
right? Let's decide this by consensus.
Sorry about this. Yeah, I've tried that. Okay. So, in the interest of time, we could just use our imagination of how this. Okay, we're gonna ignore all of this. All that. Great. All right. Thank you so much. Again, it's a real pleasure to be with all of you to share information about my background and thinking and the work that I've been doing, as Peter said, for 14 years at the Albert Einstein Institution, where I've worked with the scholar Gene Sharp on both developing and promoting both the study and use of strategic nonviolent action in conflicts around the world. It's also wonderful to be here with so many of you in this room that have yourselves been working for so long on building more peaceful and just communities, both in your backyards and around the world. So thank you very much for this honor. Most of us would like to see a future of less violence and oppression. But the reality is that violence is continuously used and supported by people who believe that it is justified for so-called good purposes. The idea that violence is necessary to address the world's most serious political problems like dictatorships, invasions, oppression, occupations, and racial and economic injustice comes from a belief that it's the most powerful means available. It's a judgment about political reality, not one that is usually based on religious or principled beliefs. That means that it's unlikely that people will stop using violence in response to moral denunciations. Of course. I must do it manually. This isn't how I planned it. But it's okay. Above all, we must be flexible. Okay. I like that. I have experienced war and its terrible consequences firsthand. As a child in Afghanistan during the Soviet invasion and occupation of the country in the 1980s. So some of my earliest memories were in thinking through issues related to war and violence and conflict and oppression. But here's the thing. I was both horrified by the impact of war and the cost on society, but also quite comfortable justifying the use of resistance violence for purposes that I viewed as important, namely in defense of my family and in my country. The guerrilla resistance by the Afghan population, which went on for 10 years and eventually led to the defeat of the Soviet occupation, was seen widely as a success by people around the world and by Afghans themselves. Imagine a war that killed millions of people, created millions more refugees, destroyed the entire infrastructure of the country, seriously disrupted its education system, its culture, and its language. It was seen as a success. But even with all of that destruction, I don't recall ever having met an Afghan who thought it would have been better to do nothing or to give up. I share this with you now because a lot of people are surprised to learn that I didn't come to the work I do now as a pacifist. I came to the work as someone who believes firmly in the fundamental right of people to resist injustice against them. Injustice against their families and injustice against their communities. I believe strongly that people facing oppression have the right and maybe even the responsibility to use the strongest means that are available to fight for what is important to them. Okay, so this is all. I'm going to put the lights back on. Well, just that one. Welcome to your presentation. Is this okay? Everyone okay?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, thank you. And we can't rely on technology. Right. Violence perpetrated for a political end seems to dominate our television screens these days and our societies. In the short time since we've arrived in this little piece of heaven, an attack in Dhaka in Bangladesh killed 20 people in a cafe. Just a few days before that, an attack in Afghanistan killed 30 young men, police recruits that were on their way to Kabul to receive their diplomas with their whole lives ahead of them. I'm completely the slide at this point. Last week, we saw the brutal attacks in Turkey that killed ordinary citizens from at least 10 countries just traveling through Atatürk Airport, or people who work there. From leaders and policymakers around the world, we heard condemnations of the violence and prayers for the victims and the families impacted by the tragedy. Condemnations and prayers have their role in society, but as important as they are not enough. Because they do very little to actually stop these atrocities. Lectures to people who use terrorism from government leaders with access to hugely superior military capacity, urging them to renounce violence as immoral, does nothing to stop this act. People who perpetrate these attacks are usually people with deep grievances against their opponents. And they share something with the world's common political view, and that's that violence gives them more power than anything else that they can do. Heads of state of most governments and their people who use the people who use terrorism agree on something fundamental, and that's for their own purposes, violence is politically necessary and morally justified. People who justify violence for political ends usually resort to terrorism out of a sense of desperation, to counter feelings of powerlessness, to express hatred for past wrongs against them, to address injustices, to advance their cause, and to help their people. As long as such people continue to see violence as their greatest source of power, why then would they choose to weaken themselves by renouncing it? Asking people who have a fundamental issue at stake to give up violence or nothing for nothing, or asking them to negotiate with their opponents in face of oppression and violations of their human rights and their political rights is understandably not usually a compelling argument for them. If we want to see less violence in the world, we must have an alternative way to fight for the objectives that are important to people. That tool must be at least as powerful and as effective as violence and war, because only then will it be more often used in place of violence and war. Fortunately, we have such an alternative to violence and passivity. Since at least 494 BC, before Genoeth and before there have been over 1,000 recorded cases across cultures and religions, in which people have chosen to fight not with violence, but instead with psychological, social, economic, or political weapons. They have used what we call the technique of nonviolent struggle, also known as civil resistance or people power. Overwhelmingly, when people have abandoned violence in favor of nonviolent struggle, they have done so for pragmatic and strategic reasons. Simply put, they believed it was the best way available to them to achieve their aims. Nonviolent struggle as a concept has historically been prone to misconceptions, and I'm grateful to Erica for having addressed many of those in her talk yesterday. Historically, there's been a lack of understanding and clarity about what nonviolent struggle is and what it is not. So let's start with the definition. Nonviolent struggle is a technique where a population can mobilize itself to restrict or cut off the sources of power of their opponent in order to achieve particular social and political objectives. Nonviolent struggle consists of many methods, and the list of 198 methods that you may be familiar with is just a start. These methods range from mild symbolic protests, social boycotts, to more powerful economic boycotts, labor strikes, political non-cooperation, and finally, nonviolent intervention, the most powerful category of methods in the nonviolent arsenal. The approach on which we focus at the Albert Einstein Institution is pragmatic and strategic. This is Jean Sharp's foundational work. We focus on the operation of the technique as a strategic tool. And we do this by studying how nonviolent struggle has been used throughout history and how it's being used today. And we ask questions like, when nonviolent struggle was used, how did people do it? When nonviolent struggle was successful, why was it successful? And when it failed, what were the reasons that caused it to fail? By asking these questions, we have uncovered important insights and knowledge that can be useful to groups struggling for diverse social and political objectives today. Nonviolent struggle is both extremely complex and very basic. The fundamental basis of the work is pretty easy to understand. Getting a detailed understanding of the technique requires a lot of time and careful study. That knowledge is available through many books and films and other resources, including through our publications on the website of the Albert Einstein Institution, as well as other organizations that make much of this work available for free download. Nonviolent struggle is not about how to change the heart of your oppressor or how to ask politely for your rights. It's about how to seize political power and to deny it to your opponents. It's a technique based on the power of basic human stubbornness, something we all have. We're actually bored with it. The determination and ability to defy, to refuse to cooperate, and to disrupt. So people refuse to do what they're told to do, and they do that which is forbidden. The power of these analyses and their potential to address serious political problems led a man named Audrius Kutkevicius, Lithuanian Minister of Defense, to say about one of our books called Civilian-Based Defense, "If I had to choose between the atom bomb and Gene Sharp's book, I would choose this book." That's the Minister of Defense.
Wow.
So we should reflect on that. A person in charge of providing for the defense needs of their country said that the power that he and his society could wage through the ideas contained in a book were more powerful than the atom bomb. The significance of such a statement is something that should give us pause, and especially to all of us who would like to see a less violent world. There are costs that can be inflicted through nonviolent means that an opponent will not be able to withstand or endure. And if you look at the words and responses of the entities that are the targets of these nonviolent struggles, you'll find a lot of evidence of this. And I spoke yesterday in my workshop about this recent study that was commissioned by energy companies. The business analysts in London, they concluded that fracking companies should simply avoid doing business in areas where the population was mobilized against them, because the cost of the fight was simply too high, because it cut into their profits. There's nothing in the report where they express sympathy for the resistors or acknowledge the justness of their cause. They're simply unwilling to accept the costs associated with an empowered society. Throughout history, when nonviolent struggle has been used, it's often been spontaneous, with almost no strategic planning and very little tactical planning. Rarely we've seen strategic geniuses like Gandhi and a few others. Gandhi was able to plan and wage the Indian independence movement using a combination of his own deep insight into the nature of power, historical knowledge, understanding of his own people, understanding of his opponent. But even he said that he had learned from other people, other struggles that had come before him. He said, "We must learn from this Russian method." He learned about the way the general strike was used in the Russian Revolution of 1905, the Chinese boycott of American goods in 1900, and the American colonists' refusal to pay taxes to the British, among other examples. But mostly nonviolent struggle has been used by people who didn't really know what they were doing, who were incredibly brave and defiant, but who were mostly operating on very little knowledge and a lot of intuition. In spite of this lack of planning and access to knowledge that could make what they were doing more effective, people conducting these struggles achieved important victories. But at this point, we no longer need to reinvent the wheel. The chance that a nonviolent struggle will be successful can be greatly increased if people act in accordance with a wise plan. A wise plan requires a detailed understanding of the situation, which many people already have, as well as a detailed understanding of how nonviolent struggle operates, which everyone can gain. Contrary to what many people believe, nonviolent struggle is not the time to operate on intuition or spontaneity. While being flexible, as we concluded earlier. Just as we wouldn't expect a soldier to march his soldiers into battle without a strategy and an in-depth understanding of military conflict, nonviolent struggle also demands of its participants certain skills, capacities, and knowledge. Almost every single group that I've worked with at the Albert Einstein Institution has started our conversation by telling me the same thing. Their situation is unique. The obstacles are too high to waging effective nonviolent struggle. Yet they're still there talking to me, so that's curious. That's the power of hope, right? They say that the challenges that they face are particularly severe when compared to this country or that country where it has worked. And it's true that every situation is unique, and there are no cookie-cutter solutions to any of our political problems. But there are general conditions that marginalized communities face throughout the world, and if we learn about these, we can learn how to change them. If we look around the world, we see that many people today feel powerless. Even in countries that are considered more democratic, many people feel they are powerless to improve their society in any significant way, or powerless to preserve their rights against gradual erosion. Sometimes people complain that there's a general sense of apathy in their societies, and that people just don't care about politics or social issues. So their goal is, how do we make people care so that they can become more engaged? But I think it's a mistake to think that people don't care, because much of what appears as apathy is actually a mask for feelings of helplessness. Because if people feel that there's nothing that they can do to change a situation, then they're going to see their own problems as unsolvable and themselves as powerless, and so they'll do nothing. So as a start, those of us who want to change the conditions in our communities should recognize this problem and identify the steps we can take to change it. And this is really key. People who feel weak must begin to understand their own power. The next step is to figure out where we are weak, and then to identify the deliberate efforts we need to take to reduce those weaknesses. Because only then can we bring fundamental change in our communities and our societies. And fundamental change means that we go beyond bringing attention to the problems, which a lot of people are very good at. But it's not enough to protest injustices. It's not enough to just declare opposition to certain policies, to conditions, because that does nothing to build a better future. We must work deliberately to strengthen ourselves so that we can change those policies and conditions. This all sounds very nice, so how do you do it? It's important to be very careful when pushing people to take action at a point when they feel weak. If people are asked to take action that goes beyond their capacity, their predictable defeat will prove to them that they are helpless as they always thought they were. And it may be a long time before they're willing to act again. But if people are motivated to participate in limited actions within their capacity that they feel they can carry out, even if it starts small, that's a different matter. There's a case from apartheid South Africa that illustrates this very well. At one stage in the struggle, the African National Congress was trying to organize resistance, but it seemed to them that it was impossible to mobilize people. People felt weak, they lacked organization, they lacked confidence, they felt too afraid to act. In the face of the overwhelming problems they faced, the power of the apartheid system, their problems felt too overwhelming to do anything about. Asking people to unite for the sake of grand and noble objectives like freedom and equality wasn't working. So the leadership decided to back up. And instead of assuming that everyone was thinking about freedom and equality, they decided to figure out the specific issues that actually impacted people's lives. And in one township, when people were asked what their biggest problem was, they didn't say the injustice of the apartheid system. They said that the issue that most impacted their lives at the time was a lack of clean water. People were getting sick from drinking the polluted water, and their children were dying. So the leadership decided to try something else. They didn't tackle the apartheid regime, even though they knew the regime was largely responsible for the injustices that they faced. They tackled the issue of getting clean water. They carried out a campaign in a particular township to force the government to build a well. And on that single issue, the people acted and the people won. The campaign for clean water had important consequences in terms of mobilizing people's efforts, empowering the population, building their confidence that they could achieve larger goals. Even though their success was limited in terms of scope and geography, they gained a greater understanding of their own capacities. The success of the campaign made them think, I wonder what else we can do. The example from the apartheid South Africa is known as is what is known as a constructive program, a term coined by Gandhi. In the context of nonviolent struggle, constructive programs serve people's basic needs, they foster self-reliant communities, they create unity, and they inspire people. Gandhi said that attempting nonviolent struggle without constructive programs was like a paralyzed hand attempting to lift a spoon. In fact, the most effective social movements have recognized that self-reliance and meeting the needs of their communities plays a huge role in social and political empowerment that can be harnessed for all kinds of objectives. Bacha Khan of the Northwest Frontier Province recognized this well also. He said that the oppression of the Pashtuns in the larger community of India was only possible because they were weak. He said, as a prerequisite to waging struggle, they must strengthen themselves. It's unfortunate, then, that people who are understandably impatient for political change don't recognize that in the greatest social and political movements throughout history, the leaders have recognized this well, and that there have been these prerequisite capacity-building programs that have served as the first step in making change that is effective, fundamental, and lasting. There's an incredibly long history to nonviolent struggle. Most of you in this room know that. It's been widely practiced in different parts of the world by diverse populations for different objectives. But much of this history has been neglected or ignored in favor of highlighting stories of violence and war. This gives people the false idea that progress and human rights and the democratic freedoms that we do have now, for the moment, were won through violence and war, and that it is violence and war that we must use to conduct our struggles. For example, did you know that one of the most historically significant nonviolent struggles in the world took place right here in this country, long before the civil rights movement? It's fitting that we speak about this important case today as we are gathered here as our country is celebrating Independence Day. According to the narrative that we're taught in our schools and in our films, it was the Revolutionary War that brought U.S. independence from British rule. And that whole history, and that whole period in our history, is taught as just a series of battles and military confrontations. But the actual historical record shows a very different story. Resistance against British rule did not begin with the battles of Lexington and Concord. What most people don't know is that in the years leading up to the American Revolutionary War, the colonists conducted a massive nonviolent struggle that achieved de facto independence from the British through three major campaigns against the Stamp Act, the Townshend Act, and the Coercive Act of 1774, as well as the Continental Congress. Most of the colonies, they say 8 out of 13, in fact were functioning independently months before the battles of Lexington and Concord, before the violence. At the Albert Einstein Institution, we're reissuing an important book that covers this period. It's going to be called Before Lexington. It's really important that we preserve this history. I do want to speak a bit about this case because it's very, very exciting. In the course of their struggle, the colonists developed and used nonviolent methods that ranged from protest and non-cooperation to the creation of parallel institutions, political, judicial, and executive bodies that challenged British authority. They explored and tried out new methods and techniques. They used petitions, protest marches, demonstrations, boycotts, refusal to work. They also used non-cooperation, social non-cooperation. When colonial merchants imported English goods that the colonists were boycotting, people not only refused to buy from them, but also to talk to them or to sit with them at church or to sell them goods of any kind. They spun and wore their own homespun cloth. They held massive protests. They established local resistance committees. They established newspapers that reported their resistance communities, activities, and built support for the opposition. Although there's not a lot of information about it, women played an essential role in many of the local campaigns because they made the decision about household and family purchases. And to a large degree, they were able to bring about the success of the boycott campaigns. The British reaction was swift and harsh, as is to be expected. To punish the people of Massachusetts for their defiance, they closed Boston Harbor until the tea that was thrown overboard was paid for. They threatened the livelihood of the population. They banned town meetings that were held without the royalist government's consent. And they stipulated that British soldiers be housed in people's homes. But as often happens, the repression didn't have the intended consequences. Instead of subduing the population and isolating Massachusetts, the repression only caused increased defiance among the people and brought outside support for Massachusetts from other colonies. The non-cooperation and defiance in Massachusetts was so massive that in early 1774, the governor of Massachusetts, the British representative in the area, is reported to have said, "I have no power outside of my own home." Love that quote. You can tell I love that quote, right? These acts of resistance were carried out nonviolently, but the choice to use nonviolent means, as far as we know, was not based on principled opposition to violence. It was a clear pragmatic choice. They were using the means by which they reasoned they would most likely achieve their objectives. The resistance continued and grew. The colonists set up their own judicial system to settle disputes outside of the British courts. They organized alternative forms of government. Toward the end of the nonviolent struggle, many of the systems and bodies that were set up were more powerful than whatever remained of the British government. By the time that the colonies declared independence in 1776, they had an incredibly advanced democratic governance. And in this way, the institutions and the networks of power that were established to carry out resistance and to demonstrate opposition and to organize, those same institutions played a major role in the country's transition to a democratic system. In spite of these massive achievements, the people-led nonviolent revolution to free the colonies from British rule is generally ignored or forgotten. Instead, it's the war that commonly defines what people understand as the American Revolution. This is a problem because how can we know what is possible for the future if we don't have an understanding of what has been made possible by brave and courageous people in our past? Today, nonviolent struggle is being used in ways that is unprecedented in terms of thought, skill, and planning. Although the planning phase of nonviolent struggle is not well documented in the media, it's exciting to see how activists are innovating in terms of using strategic and long-term thinking. Which brings us to an important point. As activists learn and innovate, so do their opponents. Intelligence agencies of several governments have interests. Governments around the world, including our own, have commissioned studies on how to understand and undermine nonviolent movements. Their national military, local police departments have conducted training exercises on how to more effectively suppress protests. The challenges to conducting successful nonviolent struggle are many and can seem overwhelming. But the good news is that developing these strategies that have a chance of working are within people's capacity. The tools to do it skillfully exist. They're being improved and refined by people around the world every day. This type of knowledge and understanding will make the struggles of the future more effective and strategic than those of the past, including the recent past. It's up to us to contribute to that so that we see a future of less violence and oppression. Iyad al-Baghdadi is an important Arab Spring activist who was deported from the United Arab Emirates and currently lives in Norway, where I met him. He said, "Those who want liberty must organize as effectively as those who want tyranny." The technology that young people, and all the rest of us do. The technology that people are using has changed the battlefield of nonviolent action. But its effects are more complicated than many people realize. We all know that social media has played a huge role in making participation in nonviolent movements spread like wildfire in past decades. However, if we think about the importance of constructive programs and the strengthening of communities, we can also see how social media activism can distract from building a real, durable movement with the strength to win. The scholar Zainab Tofiksi makes an important point in her awesome TED Talk. New technologies and social media tools reduce the cost of organizing. It sounds good, right? But here's a problem, because these technologies bypass what used to be a more difficult process. And this is the process of building a movement. In the struggles of the past, 50 years ago, 20 years ago, maybe even 10 years ago, it would take weeks and months and years to build the networks that are necessary for even one specific action like a demonstration or a protest. In order to do that, the movement would have to build a strong leadership structure and a system for decision making. Now you can get large numbers of people in the streets without having first gone through these important initial steps. Numbers are important, of course. Nonviolent struggle depends on large-scale participation. But what's more important than the quantity of participation is the quality of the participation. And in the case of some of these recent struggles, like Gezi Park protests and the World Cup protests in Brazil, even Occupy Wall Street, people, observers see thousands of people in the streets. And it's understandable that they would think that change is inevitable, because there's no way that so many people could be dissatisfied with particular policies, make their views known, and their opponents would still somehow withstand that. But we're seeing precisely that. Opponents are able to withstand large-scale protests when that's all that people are doing. Here's why. Because just because you've managed to get people in the streets to demand change doesn't mean necessarily that they fully understand the objectives of the movement or that they have an understanding of what is required of them, how they should behave if arrested, how to respond to repression, the importance of maintaining nonviolent discipline. They may not have the long-term commitment to sustain the goals of the movement, including the tough work of continuing the struggle even once the victory is won. Because as we know, and as we have learned from recent history and the Arab uprisings, victories require defending. So even if an initial victory is won, people can remain as helpless as they were before, unable to respond to new challenges when they arise. And they will arise. That's why Gandhi said another of my favorite quotes: "If you give me independence on a silver platter, I don't want it." It's not always about the end game, about achieving the objectives alone. Equally important is the process of empowerment and for planning for what follows, so that groups conducting a struggle do not replace one oppressive system for another. Here in the United States, we have seen a resurgence of people power movements with the rise of Occupy Wall Street and more recently, Black Lives Matter. When Trayvon Martin was killed, it was the spark, like in Tunisia with the self-immolation of Mohamed Bouazizi, where the brutality of the systemic oppression becomes obvious and compels people to act. Since then, the Black Lives Matter movement has spread, gaining concrete legislative and policy victories in a number of cases, and dramatically affecting the public conversation in this country. We know that these victories are just a chip in the large structure of systemic racism in our country and beyond. But these victories should not be underestimated, because a war is won through a series of battles. Celebrating and acknowledging these victories is an important way to draw people to the cause, to create unity in the movement, and most of all, to grow momentum. The path of small and identifiable victories is the path to fundamental change. And how the movement capitalizes upon these victories will determine its future and whether it will fundamentally change the larger structure of injustice in the United States. Sorry. There's an abundance of historical evidence of how nonviolent struggle has been employed by people and the successes that it's achieved. In spite that, as we said, it was mostly used by people with very little strategic know-how. But we are at a stage now where we need to move beyond the discussion of its limitations. We need to focus on its possibilities and its future potential and work to make that real. Let's look at where it has worked and how it has worked and how we can make it work better so that we can continuously and incrementally decrease the purposes for which we now use violence. It's a lack of understanding of nonviolent struggle that is one of the major obstacles to its adoption and effective application. A widespread shift to nonviolent struggle requires that greater knowledge of its requirements, strategy, operation of nonviolent action, so that people may more often explore its use for their situations. For example, if we want to stop terrorism, we must search for effective nonviolent means to wage conflict at all levels, including fighting dictatorships, corruption, providing for national defense. Let's pay attention to the struggles that are taking place in countries around the world. We need to do what we can to bring attention to these struggles, people struggling bravely in spite of massive risks, repression, and even torture. When we ignore these important struggles being conducted by courageous people, using powerful nonviolent means, achieving important successes, we're sending a very dangerous message. And that is that it's violence that gets the attention of the media and the international community. The end of political violence is closely linked with our ability to find new ways of conducting conflict, new ways of organizing power in society, and with the ongoing need to strengthen the capacity of ordinary people. People who may feel powerless today, but who can develop the capacity to change their societies and the world, in fact. People around the world are exploring the potential of nonviolent means as a realistic and powerful alternative to violence and their struggles for greater freedom. The knowledge that this technique exists, that it's been used for centuries, not perfectly, but with lots of effectiveness, also by people who were not saints and martyrs, but ordinary people like all of us. Some of you may be saints. This knowledge alone is very empowering. That this type of struggle can be learned, that it can be improved and used even more effectively to conduct struggles is eye-opening for people, and it reveals possibilities that were previously unknown to them. Like the protester in Yemen said a few years ago, in talking about the government, he said, "They can't defeat us because we left our weapons at home." That should give us pause. People realized that what was thought to be a tool of power, having access to guns, could actually be a weakness, and that another method of seeking political change was actually the real power. It's a stunning realization. Once again, let me thank all of you here and the Fellowship of Reconciliation for your long support for our work and for a more peaceful and just society and world. I really appreciate this opportunity to speak with all of you today, and I look forward to hearing your questions and your comments and to continuing this conversation. So, thank you very much.
Under 30 seconds.
Yeah, be quick so we can get as many as we can in before our break.
Okay, so I'm Mary Ryan Hoskins. My question relates to
you used some examples of shunning of opponents or things that pertain to overthrow of occupiers or dictators. But what about this situation that MLK proposed in terms of making a beloved community where after the resistance is over, we want to be able to live together as a community?
Well, thank you for your question and for your comments. I think that that's very good and ideal, an ideal situation to work toward. I think my personal view and experience from having done this work and having lived among communities that are facing extreme oppression and violence is that that is not always possible as a prerequisite, that you can't ask people to, that may be the goal at the end for all of us. We want those beloved communities, but I think it may start somewhere else to begin with, and that placing that as a prerequisite and a condition to using effective nonviolent struggle, which allows that beloved community, is, I think, perhaps we must embrace that pragmatic approach because of the reality of the world. But I commend you for having that view.
My question is somewhat like the former one. You quite understandably talk about the effectiveness of it changing politically without changing people's hearts. Here in the United States, of course, as you know, we have some experience of the civil rights nonviolence, which in fact did change people's hearts and seemed to contribute to the eventual positive outcome. Do you have stories from Afghanistan or other similar places where in fact the military opposition, others who were passively supporting it, were changed because of the nonviolent resistance?
Yeah, I think there's lots of examples where, because of the nonviolent nature of the movement, it allows certain dynamics, like that it increases defections, it reduces the willingness of soldiers and security forces to use violence against nonviolent protesters. This is infinite cases of that. I would agree with you that's a dynamic. I think that, I guess I agree with you that it changes hearts, but more often it imposes a cost on the violence. So it shows the oppressor, the opponent, the person that is charged with carrying out those violent acts against nonviolent protesters, that there is a price to pay. That price to pay is reduced respect from your society. There are international repercussions to doing that. And it's obviously, because of the dynamics of nonviolent resistance, it's much more difficult to use violence against nonviolent protesters than it is to use against protesters or against violent groups.
Hi, my name is Carolyn from Seattle, and I had a leftover question from your lecture yesterday. It seems like the whole scenario is based on time. If the violent oppressors have enough time, then they think they can squash the nonviolent protesters. At what point does the nonviolence method seem to take over and more people join? It seems like a timeline to me. Could you respond to that?
Well, like much of everything in life, probably there is a timeline that is relevant. I think it would differ so widely that I'm not sure there's anything that, I mean, probably Erica has stuff in her research that maybe can provide some insight into that. But I think we have this perception that nonviolent struggles take forever and that violence is quick. We know there's obviously protracted conflicts going on for decades, and nonviolent struggles that that achieve important gains in a relatively short period of time.
My question relates to, in America, we have different systematic institutions that are actually used to repress protests. So prime example, we're supposed to have the right to protest and gather publicly, and yet police are always called. And if we look at the revolution in Egypt a few years ago,
that led to the exile of the president, of their president at that time. The police actually did not actively resist the protesters. Personally, I think that comes from the psychology of capitalism, of always having somebody to look down on, somebody that you can oppress no matter where you are. And my question is, if you're going to be nonviolent, you would need some of the systematic pieces that are there to oppress you to also meet you at that place of nonviolence. What would be your suggestion when you're meeting those who are resisting you and not even from their own personal agenda or goal or beliefs, but simply because that is what they are supposed to do in their position, which is the idea of the Nuremberg defense. Well, I only did it because Hitler said, I only do this because it's my job. This is how I feed my family. I have to go out and do this to the protesters and whatever the case. Do you have any ideas or anything that you've seen work that goes towards meeting those people in a very human place and maybe urging them to deal with those who are demonstrating nonviolently in a more humane way that's not just about repression?
Yeah, it's a very good question. I think that messaging and information can play an important role in conveying to security forces that they're not the targets of the struggle, that in fact it's a system of which both the population and perhaps even the security forces are victims. And I think that's why messaging is important. But I think you've in part answered your own question, which is that soldiers and security forces are taught to obey, and that they often do, but often they have not. There's ways in which you can reduce the reliability of a system's, the enforcer of their policies. And there's ways in which you can cause those defections. That's, I think, why it's really important to study how that's happened throughout history and how we can encourage that too. But we shouldn't take for granted cooperation and obedience to an oppressive system, because that's also not natural. And so I think that there's times when even despite the training, people have disobeyed that cooperation, and so we don't need to take it for granted. I think just as in our soldiers and our security officers are received good training in order to obey, so also did many of the police and military in Egypt. They also were very well trained, and yet they defected, and they have defected in a number of other cases.
So my question has something to do with an answer to, I think, what your question is. I'm not sure. It has to do with the American Revolution, and you identify the Stamp Act and these different taxation strategies and actions. In reading Ellen Brown's work in public banking and the source of debt, there was another key piece, which was that the colonists developed their own currency systems, and this is what empowered the local people, took the power away from the banking institutions, and allows people, I mean, it gives them that power by creating the currencies that enable their economies to do what the local people want to do, which gives options to, you know, they just, this is the work that I have to do in order to make a living. So are you aware of that, or do you concur with the... with that strategy being very, very key to our success of having independent local financing capacity in order to finance the work for everybody that needs to be done?
Yeah, thank you for that. I think that the creation of institutions, including alternative financial structures, is incredibly important in societies where people feel the current system is not meeting their needs. And I think that's very important. And I think it's exactly the kind of example of moving beyond just protesting that capitalism is not serving our needs, and that we, you know, but actually creating this other system to perhaps in limited ways take its place. so that, you know, we can, more effectively meet the needs of our communities. And it may be a long way before we come up with anything to replace it in a way that meets the needs of our country and the world. But in the meantime, it can play a very important role in our communities. It would be interesting to learn more about what you're referring to.
Okay, so we have about 15 minutes left, or less now, but since I looked at my phone. And I'd like to get some other new voices in, too, if possible. So, new voices.
I'm just thinking of how the government preemptively cut down a movement. I don't know if it was 12 or 16 years ago when the Republican convention was in New York City. And it's personal because my daughter was so excited. But they preemptively, before the convention even started, there was a demonstration of Friday night on bikes. That was a normal thing. But all of a sudden, they like arrested all the kids who were, there was a larger group doing it that night. And that just like cut the spirit so intensely. And then also the way they restrict where you can't even be near the place anymore. So they really, as you mentioned, have gotten so sophisticated so that you can't be doing protests. So I'm just wondering, what are we learning? How do we counteract that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of new laws that criminalize protests around the world, including in countries that are more democratic. I mean, in France and Spain and here. Yes. Will, you had already mentioned that. Yeah, so I think people are using new and creative ways. They're learning that maybe the symbolic demonstrations are just one thing you can do, and then there's all of this other important methods that can be employed to sometimes achieve more. So I think that maybe people are diversifying their methods and tactics. They're also sort of circumventing some of these laws against protests. Like I saw one, and I'm pretty sure it was in Spain, where they were doing there was a law against protesting in front of government buildings. And so they did a hologram protest, basically filming themselves and beaming the... It's an incredibly powerful picture also, yeah. And I think it was also... I think it was Tajikistan, where there's a law against congregation of more than a few people. And so they didn't call for a protest. They called for let's all meet in town and eat an ice cream while walking down the street. What's the government going to do? Arrest you for eating an ice cream? So I don't know. I don't know. I don't have a good answer for your question. But I think people are figuring it out in the various ways that people do.
Can we make some space for youth and others that are here, too? To ask questions.
Thank you, Jamila, for the wonderful talk. I was just wondering, what is our relationship like? What's the relationship of the Institute like with principled nonviolence? So you talked about Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, or Pasha Khan, or Gandhi, or MLK, or I don't know. You can think of Aung San Suu Kyi any longer as a principled nonviolent activist. Where do we stand now? Do we have pragmatic or pragmatic nonviolence? How do you look at that sort of strand of nonviolence? What started all of this in our generation? Anyway, thank you.
Yeah, I think perhaps it's not so important that we focus so much on that distinction. And at the institution, what we have said for a long time is that there is a very important role, often a very central role, that people with the belief system, the role that they can play in participating and conducting effective nonviolent struggle. And we have a paper called The Role of Believers in Nonviolent Struggle, for example, on our website. And so there is that strong role we have emphasized. And the only sort of caveat would be that as long as people with that belief system, the pacifists, people with religious or principled background, don't present that as a prerequisite, that is what is required in order to participate effectively in nonviolent struggles. Because if that's the case, then we're going to limit our movements to most of the world. And so I think that if we want to see less violence in the world, we have to create movements that are inclusive and that, you know, work with people that we may not agree with 100%. And so that's the sort of institutional approach. I've learned a lot in my 2 days here. I think that, you know, we're working in a field with so many misconceptions about nonviolent struggle that historically we have been worked very hard to make that distinction. And I think people, perhaps, I hope at least, are beginning to recognize that there are different belief systems that can contribute and add to effective nonviolent struggle. But at the end, what we want is effective nonviolent struggle. And I think we, well, all of us, whether with the belief system or not, should remember that.
The biographical sketch of Gene Sharp on the Albert Einstein Institution website says that Gene Sharp has consulted with the pro-democracy groups and other groups in a number of countries, including Burma, Thailand, Tibet, Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, and Belarus, and elsewhere. And I would be especially interested in hearing about the work in Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, and Belarus, and has there also been work with Ukraine for nonviolent national defense against the Russian invasion of Crimea and eastern Ukraine?
Well, I guess it would depend on how you define worked with. Much of what we do in terms of advancing this understanding and spreading this knowledge is by distributing books. Because of capacity. We're now 5 people doing work that is massively in demand, and there are still very, very few organizations doing this specific work. So you can imagine the sort of number of inquiries we get. So, we've sent books and sent material to people in all the countries you mentioned. There has historically been, in a sort of 10 to 15 year period, Gene Sharp and other people associated with our work did workshops and consultations with groups in conflict, sometimes in their countries, usually not, usually in neighboring countries. And these consultations and workshops were basically to convey the generic know-how, the strategic know-how of how nonviolent struggle works and how people might apply it for their situations. And if that's listed in his bio, then I guess that would all be very true. And I think in the Baltics was a very interesting case, very specific case, and I mentioned the defense minister, Andrius Butkevicius, which was actually at the time a shadow government, an independence-minded government that was trying to resist Soviet occupation and declare independence, and they did so using civilian-based defense, which is a book that Gene Sharp wrote, which was published in 1980. And the page proofs of that book were spread very widely among the Baltic countries, and they have reported that they developed a resistance movement that engaged the population in order to basically defeat Soviet occupation, and they credit our work with having helped them achieve that. That was in part made possible because of both the written material, and Gene Sharp was there in the basement of the Ministry of Defense, working with the Minister of Defense, developing a nonviolent plan. Quite incredible history, largely unknown.
Thank you, Jamila, for helping us translate idealism into practicality. I have a question. It's in my memory, and I can't remember the name, there was an Afghan pacifist during the 19th century, during the wars with the British. And I wonder if you know of that individual and could tell us a bit about his story.
Yeah, that's right, Bacha Khan. Yeah, that's Bacha Khan. His full name is Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan. He is a hero of the Afghan people and also people around the world who understand what he did and how remarkable it was, and how it does away with so many of the misconceptions we have about human capacity and nature being so violent. the Pashtun people, the Afghan people, having a history of violence. They also conducted one of the most disciplined and effective nonviolent struggles in the history of the world. And at the end, it was started as a reform movement in the 1920s. And I mentioned earlier that it's a great example of capacity building, a recognition that the oppression was only possible because the tribes and the people living in the cities in that region at the time were so weak. There were so many internal problems. And so they decided to put in place these massive sort of volunteer, you know, emphasis on volunteerism, emphasis on education, on including men, women, and children, including people of different religious backgrounds, Sikhs and Hindus at the time. I mean, really, the progressive nature of this movement for the time period, and I'm not going to say for the region because I think we've produced a lot of progressive thinking, it was just remarkable and very, very organized. And this was very key. They modeled it after an army, which may, you know, make some uncomfortable, but which I think had to a large degree was responsible for its effectiveness and its discipline. So they had ranks, they had uniforms, they marched, they did drills. And yeah, it was just modeled. It was an army, but nonviolent. I mean, they had a drum and bugle band. They sent the drum and bugle band to play all night in front of the British ambassador's home to show how welcome he was in the territory. Yeah. So they were incredibly cheeky and just full of life and love and humor and resistance, and it's an incredible model for the region and for the world. And here's the sad part: I knew about Bacha Khan, of course, growing up, but he had been sort of turned into this symbolic figure and lost all meaning of what he had actually done and what the people that were with him did. And I only, you know, in doing this work, went back and learned about my own history. And that's both amazing and also very sad, because imagine what kind of a model he is for young people and all kinds of people in you know, everywhere, including in that region that has had so many challenges due to violence and war.
Okay, we can take one more question, and then we're going to the Interfaith Service is going to be behind this meeting down here. So one more question.
It's up in the woods.
Just keep going. There will be a large group of people, I'm sure.
Follow the flute.
There'll be a
Japanese flute directing you up.
You know, Brianna, the golf cart is right back here. People need rides. Could you go a different route?
Golf cart is back there for anyone that didn't hear that. Last question.
I share the deep concern about police infiltration or being trained to abuse or disrupt or end or arrest people for exercising their free speech rights. One piece that I've been involved in a number of times is to actually build relationships with individual police officers, particularly ones in community policing and higher-ups. Use them to get to build relationships with higher-ups. And secondly, to actually do brief presentations to groups of police officers about what nonviolence is, and connect it with whatever concerns they have, and say, how would you like it if someone felt it was appropriate for, you know, government officials to interrupt or prevent or even hurt, you know, injure you because of your doing those things? And I think it's one of the most important pieces that we need to do more on. And we all can't do it, but I think we need to lift it up as an important thing to find one or two people within our particular group or our coalition to make that happen. So I'd be happy to talk more about it if anybody's interested.
Thank you.
Okay, that's it. Thank you.